once my soul was astray from the heavenly way, I was wretched and blind as could be. But my Savior in love gave me peace from above. And He reached down His hand for me. When the Savior reached down for me,
chapter number 11, and then Psalm, I think we'll go to Psalm 61. Matthew chapter number 11, we have tried to, in the last few messages that we have brought, we have tried to encourage God's people. We've tried to really encourage God's people not to fear, but to trust, and remembering that God is the God of all comfort, and hopefully you've been watching these messages as we try to bring them to you. Matthew chapter number 11, Jesus, of course, is speaking here, and again, let me just say this, that years ago, I used to do a kind of a local radio program, and I'm not sure if anybody even listened to it. The tower was not all that powerful. It didn't get out a whole lot, but someone said that I had a face for audio, but not for video, so I want to apologize for you, or to you, for what you're seeing right now. Anyway, just kidding. Matthew chapter 11, verse number 28, Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden light." Now, before we turn to Psalm 61, let's have a word of prayer. Father, again, we love you. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that we have to come into homes, Lord, that necessarily we would not get in. And we thank you, Lord, for those who are watching. And we pray, dear God, for our churches. Many pastors would love to get back into their pulpits and have their people back. And I pray, dear God, that you would allow that to happen very, very soon. We ask it all in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Psalm 61. Let's turn there. I want to read two verses out of Psalm 61. And again, I'm going to borrow a phrase from my preacher friend down in DeLand, Florida, Brother James Knox. And the phrase that he has put on bumper stickers, or had put on bumper stickers, is this: Jesus is still the answer. Jesus is still the answer. And I certainly believe that, and I hope that you'll see that at the end of this message. Psalm 61 and verse number 1 and verse number 2. Psalm 61, verse 1 and verse 2. Hear my cry, O God, attend unto my prayer. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Now, this world is a scene of sorrow. In fact, it always has been. One of the things that God told Eve was that her child labor would be in sorrow. In fact, he said he would multiply sorrow. Job says that we are born into trouble. We're man that is born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. So we live in a sorrowful world. It's always been that way. But in the presence, and if you probably noticed this, and I've noticed this, and anybody who has a way of listening to news knows this, that right now we are hearing most about this Chinese virus, its cases, its deaths. It changes every day. But other pandemics continue to occur, of which we're not hearing much about. Do you know that as we speak, and you know as this virus thing is going on and we have the cases being numbered and the deaths being numbered, we still have suicide all over this world. We are still seeing rape. There is still murderers. There is still pornography. There is still drunkenness and debauchery. There is still robberies. Immorality still continues, and wars and rumors of wars and earthquakes and famines and starvation, and there's still corruption and there's still greed and there's still strife and there's still unfaithfulness. But we're not hearing about that because of this virus thing. So when this Chinese virus ends and things get back to normal, what's going to be the norm? That's my question. That's what I've been thinking about. What's going to be normal once again? I'll tell you what will happen. Adultery will still go on. The bars will open. The nightclubs will still be going on. We'll still have the drunkenness. And probably, by the way, all of that probably will increase. And why is that? Well, it's sort of like people who practice all that stuff are being caged up right now. You know, they can't get out to the clubs. They can't get out to the dance halls and all that because they're closed. But once this thing is released, once this thing is over, it's going to be like releasing a wild animal. And because right now all of this stuff has been kept in check. But watch out, it's going to be like releasing that wild animal that's been caged up. And then, once again, Jesus will take a back seat. That's the way it was when 9/11 occurred. Everybody was all for prayer. Everybody was all for attending church. Everybody for about 2 weeks was all concerned and praying to God and seeking God's face and seeking God's will, but everything started to die down again. Things began to be back to normal, and then Jesus is kind of been forgotten. So I remember a long time ago when I was working in construction, this fellow hired me. I knew him from playing ball, and he hired me. And there was about four or five other fellows that I worked with. None of them were saved. I try to witness to them all the time. But we all had to ride together in a van. Not a window van, just a work van, no windows or anything, except for the drivers. And so I was stuck in the back with about four other guys. And the boss knew that I was a Christian, and he knew that I went to church. And he got them aside, apart from me, and told them, they said, "Now look, watch your language, because Jerry's a Christian. And he loves the Lord," and so forth. And so these fellows did okay. We drove about 30 miles a day to the job site and 30 miles back. And They did pretty good. Monday was okay. They watched their language. Every now and then they'd let it slip while we were driving back and forth. And Tuesday was okay. But Friday, they got the paycheck. We all got our paychecks. And man, they just started, it was just like they started letting it go. All the vulgarity and the dirty jokes and everything. And man, it just like they couldn't wait. I think it's going to be like that when this Chinese virus thing kind of goes away and people's been caged up and people's been, they hadn't been able to go out and sow their wild oats and watch out. I think that's going to happen. And then Jesus, again, will take a back seat. But Jesus is still the answer for everything. I'm going to give you three things concerning Jesus being the answer. First of all, he's still the answer of comfort for the Lord's people. You know, I think if it's not for the Word of God, if it's not for the Lord Jesus Christ, even God's people would be in a mess. But thank God, we've got the Scripture. We've got the Spirit of the Lord. The Bible speaks of the comfort of the Savior, the comfort of the Spirit. John chapter number 14, we're in Matthew, but John 14 and John 16 gives us a couple of things about the Spirit of the Lord. John 14 and verse number 16, the Bible says that the Spirit of God, which is called the Comforter, according to the Lord Jesus, he says in verse number 16, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever. So thank God we've got a Comforter, ladies and gentlemen. If you're saved, if you trusted Christ as your Savior, you have a Comforter, not just going to show up every now and then, but will be with you forever. Isn't that comforting? And then in verse number 26, the Bible says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and shall bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. So the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, is going to teach you all things. And then he says that Jesus says that he will abide with you forever and bring things, all things to your remembrance. And then when we go to John chapter number 16, again, he brings up the Comforter. John 16 and verse number 7. Nevertheless, Jesus speaking, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. Now the Comforter, the Holy Ghost, is not an it. It's not an influence, or he's not an influence. He's not some kind of a power that surrounds you. But the Bible says he is a person. I will send him unto you. Verse 8, the Bible says, and when he is come, he will reprove the world. When we skip on down to verse number 13, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. And then we see the pronouns here, the personal pronouns. He shall not speak of himself. And then again it says, whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. Verse 14 says, he shall glorify me. Verse 15 says, all things that the Father hath are mine, therefore said I that he shall take of mine and shall shew it unto you. So the Bible speaks of the comfort of the Savior, the comfort of the Spirit. And then the Bible talks about the comfort of the Scriptures. In Romans chapter 15, the Bible talks about the comfort of the Scriptures. Romans chapter number 15 and verse number 4. And you already know this, but let's read it, because every time you read the Word of God, it's a blessing to you. The Bible says, for whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we, through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, might have hope. We've been preaching a little while on hope. We've been preaching sometimes on hope. And so here we have, the Bible tells us about some Scriptures and the comfort of the Scriptures. Then the Bible speaks of the comfort in any situation. Comfort in any situation. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter number 1 that God is the God of all comfort. Back up to 1 Thessalonians, the Bible talks about the comfort of the Scriptures. It says it gives the order of Jesus' coming and it gives the outcome of his coming. You know, the Bible tells us that the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet them, the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's the order of his coming, but the outcome of his coming is so shall we ever be with the Lord. So Jesus is still the answer of comfort for the Lord's people. But secondly, he is still the answer of conviction to the lost people. In John chapter 8, in fact, this is the only time you're going to find the word convicted. In John chapter 8 and verse number 9, we all know the story of the woman taken in adultery. And they came to Jesus and they say, we caught her in the very act. What should we do? What does the law say? And they were wanting Jesus to give his opinion. But thank God Jesus didn't have an opinion to give. He had the word to give. In John chapter number 8 and verse number 9. And he stooped down in verse 8 and wrote on the ground. He just got through saying, he that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. But then in verse number 9, the Bible says, and when they heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone and the woman standing in the midst. Now, there was two things that happened here. First of all, Jesus spoke. He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. The Bible says in verse number 9, and they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience. Now, let me show you two or three things here. Number one, Jesus spoke, and then the Bible says that Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground. Now, what did he write? We don't know. There's been much speculation, and preachers have preached on what Jesus wrote on the ground. I don't know what it was, and they don't either, but I do know this. Whatever Jesus wrote was the Word of God. So there was three things that spoke to them. Number one, the Bible says that it was Jesus himself that said, he that is without sin among you. Secondly, it was what Jesus wrote. They had to see that. And then thirdly, their own conscience spoke to them and convicted them by what they heard and what they saw Jesus write. So Jesus is still the answer of conviction to lost people. Now, I'm going to give you something here. First of all, let me just say this. What if this virus thing goes away in the next, let's say the next week, next 2 weeks? What if it goes away? What if the economy, and I hope it does, what if the economy starts coming back? It just starts booming once again. People going back to work. Nobody's sick anymore with that virus. Nobody dying of that virus anymore. Our churches begin to be filled up again. People coming back to church. The economy is doing good. People's got their jobs back and all kinds. And I hope all this happens. But let me tell you this. If you're lost and all of this stuff happens, if you die, it will be to no avail. You can have a good job, making a lot of money, be healthy. And if you die without Jesus Christ, what good is it? And so Jesus is the answer for conviction to a lost soul. You need to be saved, sir. You need to be saved, man. But man is already condemned by his own sin. Now, we know what John 3:16 says. Most of us, if not all of us that's watching this broadcast, can quote that. But sometimes we fail to go a little bit past that. So let me read John chapter 3, verse number 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. That's why Jesus came. The Bible says, Luke 19:10, he has come to seek and to save that which was lost. God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world. Why is that? Well, the Bible says in verse number 18, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So, ladies and gentlemen, man is already condemned by his own sin. Verse number 19 says, and this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light. They still do, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest that they are wrought in God. So man is already condemned by his own sin. But then secondly, man needs to be convicted by his own sin. The preaching of the Word of God will convict sinners if they will listen. I'm not up here to tell you a nice story. I'm not up here to tell you that you're okay. I'm telling you that if you're saved, God will comfort you by His Spirit and by His Scriptures and in any kind of situation that you need comforted in. But if you're lost, you need to be convicted by your own sin. You need to hear the word of God and to be saved. If you'll just listen. Being under conviction simply means this: agreeing with God what he says about you and about your sin. That's why liberal churches will never bring any sinners under conviction. I was talking to a man the other day. He said that the broadcast got out to this fella. He decided to watch it, watched it for about 15 minutes, and turned it off and says, well, that man really preaches the Bible, doesn't he? And later on found out that he turned the TV on and watched Joel Osteen for about an hour and felt good about himself. Now, I'll just tell you this, Joel's a lot prettier than I am. His hair's nicer, his teeth are whiter, but his wife's not prettier. Say amen right there. So anyway, but I'm just telling you, man needs to be convicted by the precious word of God. And if these churches, if liberal churches are not preaching the word of God, they'll never be saved. But then thirdly, man needs to be cleansed from his own sin. And we know what that will, we know what that entails of. It entails of the precious blood of the Lord Jesus. Let me read three passages of scripture for you. First of all, in Colossians chapter number 1 and verse number 20, the Bible says, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. In 1 Peter chapter number 1, the Bible tells us about the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Chapter 1 of 1 Peter, verse number 19. Verse 19 says, but for as much, in verse 18, for as much as ye know that you are not redeemed or saved with corruptible things as silver and gold. You can't buy your way to heaven. There's not enough money. In fact, it's the wrong thing to have to redeem you. As such as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your father, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. Then in 1 John chapter 1, and we all know this by being familiar with it quite often. 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 7. The Bible says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. Jesus is the answer of comfort for the Lord's people. Jesus is the answer of conviction to a lost people. Lost people, look, I've heard reports and I've talked to people. Lost people are going through what they call maybe a sort of a tribulation. You know, people trying to, they're staying away from people. They can't go anywhere. They're locked up and they think this is, in fact, I've read some reports of people having heart attacks because they're thinking and dwelling so much on this thing that it's upsetting them and it's raising their blood pressure and it's causing heart attacks and a lot of other physical problems. But lost people, think about this. Lost people seem, as well as saved people now, we're all going through this together. But one day Jesus is going to come and take every saved person out of this old world, and this and look, every lost person can have this place. And then the Bible talks about great tribulation. If they're right now, if lost people are at their wits' end and they don't know what to do, they don't know which direction to turn to, if they are like that right now, what's going to happen when all hell breaks loose and they're going to go through this great tribulation? We as Christians are not going to be here, but they'll be here. And what do you think they're going to do when they go through this great tribulation? I'm glad I'm saved. And lost person, here's what I'm telling you. You need to be saved. You need to trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, because Jesus is still the answer. Well, he's the answer of comfort for the Lord's people. He's the answer of conviction to the lost people. But he is still the answer of his coming to a longing people. Are you longing for Jesus to come back? I am. Hebrews chapter number 9 and verse number 28. Now you know what verse 27, the verse 27 says, as is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment. But verse 28, Hebrews 9:28. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him, are you looking for Jesus, shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. We call Jesus' coming the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to come in the air. The Bible tells us that in 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4. But he came the first time to bear our sins. But the second time he comes to bring us home. I'm looking forward to going home. My home's in West Virginia, and I like going home to see my mom. But there's nothing like going home to be with the Lord Jesus Christ, a place prepared for his people. The Bible tells us that he himself is going to come with a shout. I know some people, I know some church people, that they don't like shouting. And I'm thinking, what are you going to do when Jesus Christ shouts? You going to run him down? I know some people that in churches, they just like a nice little quiet church. I don't believe in all that shouting. And I said, well, the Bible talks about shouting. And one day, Jesus is going to come with a shout. I think I'm going to shout too when he takes us on home, going up through the air shouting. That's going to be someday, isn't it? He's going to come back with a shout. But then our looking for him is something that will purify our lives. Purify our lives. Look, as a boy, Daddy worked on different kind of shifts. He worked on morning or evening shift sometime, midnight shift, worked on a railroad. And if Mama wanted to get me to straighten up, she would say something like this: "Your daddy will be home in just a few minutes." Boy, I'd put my halo back on and everything. And so here's what I'm saying: if we're looking for Jesus, it's going to keep us out of trouble. Now, 2 Peter chapter 3, and verse number 9. In fact, she had to tell me that quite often. Your daddy's about to come home. You better straighten up. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 9. Verse 9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us. We're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Now verse 11 says, seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved. Now we know that Jesus is going to come, and this is not talking about the rapture. This is talking about when he comes to here on the earth. But here's what he says: seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. 1 John chapter 3, and this will be our last scripture. 1 John chapter 3, and verse number 1 says, behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. Right now. Not that we're going to be. Right now we're the sons of God. We're children of God. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we've got to be better than what we are. Amen. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him. Now notice, the Bible doesn't say we shall look like him, but we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. Now look at verse 3. And every man that hath this hope, what hope is that? Looking for Jesus, God having the promise that he's coming back again and we're going to be like him. And every man that hath this hope, I hope in that, I have that. Every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. It will cause, look, if you're always looking for Jesus to come at any moment, it will cause you to straighten up, like Daddy used to tell me, straighten up, boy. But look, if we're looking for Jesus to come, we'll live godly, we'll live righteously, we'll watch what we do, watch what we say. I want to be found doing the will of God when Jesus comes. So he came to seek and to save that which was lost. When he saved you, he saved you, gave you his life, and he's coming back again. Now, Jesus is still the answer to a sinful soul, to a struggling life, and Jesus is still the answer to a steadfast hope. Are you saved? If you're saved, you have the comfort of the Holy Ghost. You have the comfort of the Scriptures. But if you're lost, I hope and pray that you'll listen to the Word of God. Get you a good old King James Bible. Begin to read the Word of God. Let the Word of God convict you of your need to be saved. And one day He's going to come back and take us on home. We've got the promise of the Scriptures that He's going to do that. Father, thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be here today. And Father, sometimes it's a little difficult for people not to be here, but we know, Lord, that wherever they are, they can be under the sound of the Word of God. And I pray, dear God, if there's one in our midst, Lord, that's in maybe in their living room, maybe they're in their garage, maybe they're just sitting in a chair watching this broadcast. Father, if they're not saved, I pray that they would realize that they're lost sinners without Jesus, and they need to trust Him and receive Him by faith. I pray, Lord, that something will be done for your honor and your glory. For we do ask it in Jesus' wonderful name and for His sake. Amen. You have a good day.
You can live as you please, but you must pay the cost. And the highway to heaven still goes by the cross.